I'm Jerry Peterson. I came down from Boston for an interview. I'm not entirely sure why, but I did. And having already been accepted at a school of nursing in a very prestigious school of nursing in Boston, which we all know the name of. At any rate, I came, I was interviewed, I was told that I was accepted, and I spent the night in the dorm in Hampton House. And it was such a wonderful, warm experience. That dorm, I just thought, wouldn't it be wonderful to come here and be in this dorm and, you know, have all my classmates around me in this dorm? And I went home and said, I'm going to Baltimore to school. So I have to thank Hampton House for my coming here.
Hi, I'm Linda Salkin-Culp, and I came for an exact opposite reason that Jerry did, and that was because when I was in high school and was starting to apply to schools, my guidance counselor said, you're good, Linda, but you're not that good. You'll never get into Hopkins School of Nursing. And I said, that's why I want to go there.
Susan Welsh Nyberg. And I was finishing high school in Western Pennsylvania and thought, oh, nursing, teaching. So I applied at Pittsburgh, which was close to my house, and they were full for the year. So my mother had read an article in Good Housekeeping or one of these magazines that rated hospitals. And the number one was Mass General, and number two was Johns Hopkins. Well, Johns Hopkins was closer, so I wrote them a letter, and I asked them if they had a school of nursing. They wrote back and said, yes, we've had one since 1886, and would you like an application? So I said, yes. So that's how I got here.
Do you remember anything about our preclinical experiences? That was before we were actually on the doing nursing practice. I was amazed that there were 90 hours of English that we took. A number of us remember Mr. Shivers. And some of the, we read Walden Pond, yeah. What other things?
Huckleberry Finn,
and Evelyn Waugh, I remember, we had. So what else do you remember about pre-clin other than our brown lab coats?
Mary Jo Steenberg and Cubilis. And one of my outstanding remembrances of brown lab coats and our brown shoes was the first time I was supposed to make a bed with a patient in it. And I was really nervous, and this woman was not very happy that I was coming in to change her bed and kept rolling her over and putting the sheets under and doing all this. And it must have taken me a half an hour. And finally I got all done, and she was on top of not only her sheet, but on the top sheet and the mattress. I had made the entire bed with her moving back and forth, and she was on top.
I'm Patricia Corbley Pichalik, and the funny thing that I remember about coming to Hopkins and being a pre-clin was when I went to get to buy my duty booties, as we called them, the brown shoes, and I lived in New Jersey, I had no idea where to go to get brown Oxfords, and I ended up at the Girl Scout store. Yeah. That's where you could find them, and when I was older, obviously, beyond Girl Scouts, and he said, what are you doing? I said, I'm going to nursing school. He said, you want brown shoes to go to nursing? I said, yes, I do.
I'm Jackie Wilson Sola. And one of the things I remember, and I had mentioned this previously, and I'm telling it because I think it's very important. Mary Price was our director of nursing, and her husband, Mr. Price, Reverend Price, was chaplain of the hospital, and he gave us a lecture. And one of the things he said to me, said to us, stuck. And he said, whatever you do, let your patient die with their dignity intact. Yep. And I have remembered that over the years. And when I go into hospitals and I go into operating rooms and they flick the sheet off and they do this and they do that, it just upsets me. A patient might be unconscious, but we've taken away their dignity. So for all of you future nurses, please keep your patient's dignity intact.
I'm Harriet Taylor Staley, and I'm a native Baltimorean. But it was that senior experience in Osler that we had to rotate through. And I believe the dreaded 2 weeks of night duty. Oh my goodness, the responsibility that we had as 20-year-olds, you know, 21-year-olds coming on. I mean, it was almost terrifying. The standards, the bar was set so high, and it was almost impossible, you know, for one little nurse to be taking care of all those patients, you know, by herself, which came down to that. You know, I think that set me up for the rest of my life. I hated nights, just hated nights. I would cry if I had to rotate through nights.
Deanna Arndt Wright. Wright Arndt, whatever. The most memorable staff person in my mind, I'm sure was the same for lots of you, was Mary Farr.
Of course.
She scared the heck out of me. I can still hear her from the end of the hall calling, "Miss Wright, what are you doing?" And usually it was something I wished I hadn't done.
I'm Diane Demarest Becker, and I want to follow up on the talk about Miss Farr. I'll give you an example of what her standards were. I had a patient who was supposed to have force fluids because they were dehydrated. I spent all day trying to figure out what that woman would drink. I got all sorts of sodas and juices and everything. I sat with her, gave her straws and coaxed her, and at the end of the day, she only had half of what she was supposed to have. So I went back to the dorm, took off my uniform to take a nap, and at 5 o'clock, the buzzer rang, and it was Miss Farr. She said, "Miss Demarest, what are you doing?" I said, "I'm taking a nap." And she said, "Get yourself over here immediately in full uniform." So I came over, and she said, "Your patient is still dehydrated. You were not fulfilling your role. You didn't give her fluids." So I said, "Well, I tried everything I could and everything." She said, "Watch." So she went to the refrigerator. She poured a huge glass of orange juice, and she rolled the patient up in bed, and she gave it to her, and she said, "Here, drink this." And the woman drank the entire thing. And it was the expectation that you would be firm, that you would do everything that you were expected to do, and going home, not having fulfilled that, just was not good enough.
I'm Beth Bernard Phillips, and on a medical floor, I had a patient who had a recent heart attack. And of course, they were on complete bed rest. And so when I got there, I had two patients that morning, and I went to the other patient knowing that they were doing rounds on my patient, and he was on complete bed rest. But when I went to his room, he said, "I need to go to the bathroom." And I said, "Well, I'll go get the urinal." And he said, "Oh no, Dr. So-and-so said, I can get up now and I want to go." So I took him to the bathroom, and I came back and I closed the curtain so he could get back in bed. And I hear this voice behind the curtain, "Miss Bernard, I need to talk to you right away." And she had her white shoes on, so I knew who it was. Anyway, so she pulls me away from the patient and said, "You could have killed your patient. You let him get out of bed. He could have had another heart attack." And I said, "Well, but the doctors told him he could get out of bed today." And she said, "Did you read those orders in the chart?" And I said, "Well, no, because the doctors just told him." And so I learned a very valuable lesson. The patient had tricked me. Mm-hmm. He didn't have a heart attack, thank goodness, but I learned to always double check things when the patient told you one thing and it wasn't in the original orders.
I'm Susan Gormley Buchanan. I have one more Mary Farr story. First night of Osler senior duty, I was reporting off in the morning, and if you all remember Mary and her fixation on bowel habits. And so you would say, and Mr. Jones had one bowel movement, and then she would say, "Well, what did it look like?" You know, I didn't know. So we went through the whole report and I was humiliated every time she asked. So the next morning, when it came time to report off, I had gone into the lab and I had gotten filter paper for every patient and a stool sample on the filter paper. So when I reported off, I said, and Mr. Jones had a bowel movement, and this is what it looked like.
Oh my God, you're fresh.
I got a great grade for that morning.
There you go, that's what was important.
That's Did she make you smell a tarry stool?
I don't recall that.
I said, did she make you smell a tarry stool? Because on my experience with her, she had a tarry stool in the bedpan and she had everyone in our rotation walk by and smell it. So they would never forget what a tarry stool smelled like.
And they
we
never
didn't.
Did.
Right.
My favorite rotation, I think, was surgery. So in those days, it was Halsted, because the whole building was called Halsted and they were all surgical floors. And my very first clinical experience of all was in the recovery room, the general recovery room. So I just want to sing the praises of Allie Sanborn, because yes. I'm sure everybody in this room loved pretty little Allie Sanborn in her spiffy white uniforms and running that recovery room, cardiac patients and all in the day, with an iron fist. But she was always just really good to students. She was always really good to me, and I was not necessarily the best student in that recovery room. So.
I have one more Mary Farr story. We all know she was a real tartar, but she was indeed probably the best geriatric nurse and instructor that you could ever ask for. And many, many years later, and continuing throughout my career as a nurse, I would come up against a geriatric patient and sort of wonder what to do. And I would think to myself, what would Mary Farr do?
Yeah.
And I did it, and it was the right thing to do. So whatever she might have scared out of us, she also put a lot into us.
Yeah,
absolutely. My name's Nancy Shartner McKelvey, and I have an experience from when we were in Harriet Lane. I had a case study patient, and when I went home from clinical one day, I had a very itchy scalp. When some of my classmates looked, I had lice. So not only did I have to treat my patient for lice, I had to treat myself and any of my classmates who were close enough that they thought everyone on the floor was thinking that they also had lice. So that was my pediatrics. So.
One of the things that I remember as being most poignant for me was when we were in OBGYN, and we were, I believe, second year students. I remember standing at the bottom of a landing and having this rather tall, gawky looking woman standing above us, asking us questions. And our instructor was with us, and we answered her questions as best we could. And then the instructor asked several of us, there was about five or six of us, to come into another room. And we went in the other room and were told that this woman was a patient of Dr. John Money's. And she was in the midst of transitioning from a male to a female. And when she was 19, she was a he. And many of the questions she asked us, which some of us thought were too personal to answer, were really out of curiosity because she had not experienced those things as she. It taught me and I guess my classmates a real lesson in sensitivity.
And I hesitate to tell this story, but we do have to tell at least one patient's story. Jeannie Haddon Schulman, who's sitting here today, was on Osler 6, a medical unit working with me. We had a gentleman who had something called Korsakoff psychosis, which is an alcoholic brain problem. And the house officers used to come around in the morning and sort of get a sense of how oriented he was and everything. And they always asked him, and this was at our expense, how did you get here? And he'd say, well, them two women over there, the redhead and the blonde, they came down to my place in Fells Point, they got me drunk, and they brought me up here and tied me up. In which case, all the house officers would laugh like crazy, and we were mortified because we were 19 years old, and we had to go through that every morning. But he was consistent. He told the same story every morning, made me wonder if we had actually done it.
I was talking with some of our classmates a couple of hours ago, and talking about the, I believe it's on Netflix, but it's elsewhere that you can get this Call the Midwife series of television shows, and how well they portrayed nurses and midwives in the early 60s. And it made me think of a time when I was in public health, and at 8 a.m. in the morning in East Baltimore, wonderful East Baltimore, walking into a bar to give a gentleman who was fairly inebriated already his insulin shot. So those were our experiences. That was one of my public health experiences that nurses I talked to today have no clue about.
When I was in public health, Jan Funkhauser Larson was on my same rotation. And one day I finished early and I said, can I help you? And she said, oh, it'd be great. She said, if there was a little girl in the hospital that had hepatitis B and the whole family needs to be inoculated with gamma globulin. So would you go and do that? I said, sure. She said, you might want to take a lot of gamma globulin and a lot of needles because I think there are a lot of people in the house. So when I got there were 12 children and the mother, and I got all finished. In those days, you had to figure out the dosage by the weight of the person, so it took a little while. And I got ready to leave, and I said, is there anyone here else? And they said, oh, yes, the man of the house. I said, okay. So the man of the house came down, and I gave him his shot, went to put the needle back in the cap, and it slipped and went right into my finger. Oops. And I looked at him, and I said, have you ever had shots for bad blood, which in those days was a synonym for syphilis? Mm-hmm. And he said, oh, yes, ma'am, I get treated right up there at the clinic. Okay, thank you. I ran back as fast as I could get back to the clinic, and they said, oh, don't worry, we looked him up. He had gonorrhea, but he didn't have syphilis. I said, okay. Well, I was newly engaged at the time, and I thought, you know, this is really kind of scary. 3 days later, I had a fever of unknown origin and ended up in the emergency room, which, of course, they're all worried about hepatitis B. I'm worried about what kind of STD did this guy really have? And everything turned out fine, but that was my experience with public health.
I think a very unique opportunity for us as students at the School of Nursing was the use of the cabin at Sherwood Forest. And someone had left that to the School of Nursing. So, you know, you could sign up in advance, someone would drive, there was a car, a station wagon that we used, and I guess we went grocery shopping even and took our food with us. So that was just a wonderful, wonderful memory, I think, to have. And then what was Goonies, the little restaurant?
Yeah, right.
Yeah, two doors over. I think
and Frank's.
Frank's, yeah, we spent a lot of time there.
One thing that we really hadn't talked about, but when we were in school, we didn't have the disposable things that people have nowadays. Everything was reusable. Little glass medicine cups, the syringes were glass and had to be pulled apart and rinsed. The needles were not disposable. Bedpans were communal. I mean, one per person, but then they got washed out and sent back. Just everything was reused, and we had to, on night shift, change the sponge sticks and redate them and things. Just, it's just so very different in this time. I guess, yeah, the disposables and the medications all came in. We had a pill bottle with, you know, 30 pills, and if the patient, we would pour them out into little white souffle cups and dispense the medicines. Now they come, you know, prepackaged per patient and things. We had to draw up individual dosages and mix the IVs. The head nurse had to mix them for 24 hours for every patient, all the antibiotics and the potassium and what have you. It was just a whole different ball game back then. But it was good.
I want to follow up on that one. Thank you, if I can. My husband was recently in the hospital and very, very ill. And the nurses spoke to me fairly often and were very nice enough to let me help them out. But what they said to me was, with all of things actually being electronic now and everything occurring like this, you must have had nothing to do in your day.
Did you hit her?
I didn't hit her, but I wanted to follow up on Sue's comment.
Right, yeah.
Because we did public health before, beepers, cell phones, cars. We went on buses, we walked all over East Baltimore. And
alone,
and we never thought a thing about it. We thought our uniform and our little black bag would protect us. And I'll tell an Alice Kiger story because Alice and I did public health in the summer. And the rule was if it was 100 degrees by 12 noon, you could come in. We all came in, one day it was 100, we all came in except Alice. Well, of course, we had no way of knowing where she was. And finally, at about 2 o'clock, a gentleman on Madison Street or something called in and said, one of you girls in them blue uniforms laying on the street here. You better come get her. And Alice, I don't know if you knew, but she had a heart problem, and that's what happened to her. I don't know what happened to her. She ended up in the emergency room, but there wasn't, today you wouldn't even think of going out without your GPS, your cell phone, everything.
And a partner.
And a buddy.
And a buddy, yeah. Right.
Or two.
I'm Martha Norton Hill, and I would like to comment on the extraordinary education that we got in ethnic and racial disparities in health and social determinants of health. And here we were in one of the greatest hospitals in the world, and it was astonishing for me, coming from Massachusetts, to see that, for example, there was a nursery for black babies and a nursery for white babies. And I had only ever seen a white baby. But I learned that the black babies were cute and wonderful, and their skin was dark, so you didn't see all of their veins. All of the patient areas, for example, in Osler, were separated. There was one floor for white women, another floor for black women, another floor for white men, and one for black men. And we learned a great deal about history, how it came to be in the history of the hospital and of Baltimore and of the country, for separation of races and ethnicity, because across the street was Sinai Hospital, which indicated the fact that the Jewish physicians were not initially allowed to practice at Hopkins. It was an extraordinary education. The other main element that impressed me always were the standards for excellence. You've heard some of the stories that the bar was set very high. You needed to know what needed to be done, you needed to know how to do it, and you needed to do it. And you needed to know why you were doing it. So one of the main mantras about a Hopkins nurse is they always ask why. They want to know what is the evidence for what needs to be done. And that led for some of us to then go on and in all throughout our careers, keep asking why. Why is this happening? Why do these patients keep getting readmitted? Why do those patients not take their medications as prescribed? And it led to wonderful careers in research and in efforts to improve patient care and outcomes.
Carlene Clasper Nelson, and sort of to follow up with what Martha just said, I think most of us while we were here had heard the stories about how Hopkins personnel could be recognized by other hospital personnel like overseas during the Second World War, etc. And I was a head nurse in labor and delivery at Washington Hospital Center in DC, probably 8 or 9 years after I left here. And as I had been taught to do, when somebody would do something, I would ask why, in terms of the physicians, not questioning their judgment, but why? And at one point, a physician called me aside and he said to me, it was only then that I learned he was a Hopkins physician background. And he said to me, Carlene, you're not at Hopkins anymore, because some of the physicians that I was questioning did not come from the same culture.
And I wanted to say that I was always very proud to be a Hopkins graduate, and it stood me in good stead in many situations. And I remember having heard along the way that you could always tell a Hopkins nurse, but you couldn't tell her much.
One of the things about Hopkins is that we got an excellent education, a well-rounded education, and one far beyond most nursing schools. I worked at Columbia Presbyterian Medical Center Hospital when I left here, and I had one of the student teachers, they had a class of about, I don't know, 15 students had come in, and the nurse asked me if I would teach her students tracheotomy care, because they had never done it. And I thought, what? But I did, and I was the person to go to for tracheotomy care after that. And it was only because of the education I got here.
What I wanted to say in terms of the impact of having been a Hopkins nursing student on my career was that having been here for 58 years now and only retiring 1 year ago, I was able to, given the kind of education, the standards of excellence, and the capacity to integrate all I was learning with the physicians, with pharmacists, with all sorts of multidisciplinary teams, to evolve through a series of educational experiences at Johns Hopkins based solely on what I learned in my first 3 years, through a master's and a doctorate, and I joined the faculty in the School of Medicine, the School of Public Health, and the School of Nursing, and was able to bring all of my nursing experience to everything I did, including publishing epidemiologic studies, some basic and clinical sciences studies. All of it was because I was a Johns Hopkins nurse. That was offered to me throughout my entire time. So I'm very grateful for having had that opportunity. Many of us have done similar things, not necessarily the same trajectory, but used that background to generate a new set of skills that made us contribute to the standards of excellence wherever we were.
My name is Jean Haddon Schulman, and I had the wonderful opportunity to be a Hopkins nurse. And at a very low point in my life, that opportunity allowed me to have two wonderful careers in nursing. My husband had passed away in 1993. At the same time, I was reunited with Nancy McKelvey, and she asked me to come be a volunteer at the American Red Cross, where she was the chief nurse. I had no idea what I would be doing, but I had just finished going back to school and with an emphasis in history. And lo and behold, 24 years later, I am still the volunteer nurse historian at American Red Cross and pretty much an expert in World War I nursing, never expected to have this wonderful opportunity, but if I'd never come to Hopkins, I never would have even known I could do all of this, and so I'm very grateful for that. And I wanted to add one story for a classmate who can't be here, Eileen Sweetland, Leinweber, and she's been a star of keeping our class together, and she gave us an interview and could tell any one of these stories we told today, but she had been, she loved ER nursing, and she told me that at the 50th anniversary, when people were going on tours, she was left by the statue, a young man came up to her and asked her, did she need help? And she said no, and she said she was here for her reunion and everything, and he was a surgical resident. And she started talking to him and telling him about the stars of the day that we knew from our time period. And she realized while she was talking, and that happens to us all, that we have this amazing history. And we got to live through the Dr. Blaylocks of the world. And she could share with this man who was in awe of her stories. There's always opportunity to pass on the wonderful story of Johns Hopkins and nurses.
One more thing that I'd like to mention is just that among the important people in our lives at Hopkins and from then on, are just our classmates. I think we pushed each other and supported one another while we were in school and since as well. We have some stars, and they include Martha as the former dean of the School of Nursing, people who have kept our class together, Diane and Jerry and Eileen, and Susan has all kinds of archives and songs and everything. Jeannie keeps our history together, and everyone else who contributes. So I think that's a very important piece of our class and what's made us some stars of the School of Nursing.